not your motorcycle.
Motorcycle is in the garage, it's very sad, why you bring that up? Sorry. All right, including this microphone, which I'm not used to, so give me a break, okay? All right, so tonight, we're gonna start in Deuteronomy, and if you are new to Word, it is Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, five back from the front. So, Deuteronomy 10, if you do not have a Bible, if you look down in front of you, under the other pew, there are some there, unless you're in the front row, in which case you better have your Word. So, I just learned that. This is a new place for me, so I just learned that a while ago. So Deuteronomy chapter 10, starting in verse 12. And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God ask of you but to fear the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to him, to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to observe the Lord's commands and decrees that I am giving you today for your own good. To the Lord your God belong the heavens, even the highest heavens, the earth and everything in it. Yet the Lord set his affection on your ancestors and loved them, and he chose you, their descendants, above all the nations as it is today. Circumcise your hearts, therefore, and do not be stiff-necked any longer. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality and accepts no bribes. He defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow, and he loves the foreigner residing among you, giving them food and clothing. And you are to love those who are foreigners, for you yourselves were foreigners in Egypt. Fear the Lord your God and serve him. Hold fast to him and take your oaths in his name. He is the one you praise. He is your God, who performed for you those great and awesome wonders you saw with your own eyes. Your ancestors who went down into Egypt were 70 in all, and now the Lord your God has made you as numerous as the stars in the sky. This is God's word. Father God, thank you again for today. Thank you for the opportunity to study your word. Thank you for this opportunity to be your church. To love you with all of our hearts, with all of our souls, with all of our mind, and Lord, yes, to challenge ourselves to obey your commands and live by your commands. Father, we thank you for your word. I thank you that your word goes forth. It goes first, and we come into it. I thank you that it challenges us to rise up. It challenges us to look inside. It challenges us to go deep. And Father, we give it to you. Lord God, I ask that minds would be open tonight, that spirits would be willing to receive your hope, your promise, your challenge, your spur, your correction, whatever, Lord, it is that each individual here needs to receive. I pray that they receive it, that they grab hold of it, that it becomes part of who they are, that they walk in it, and that they give you all the glory. Father God, I ask that you now increase as I decrease before you in Jesus' name. Amen. The title of tonight's message is Religious Affections. What does the Lord ask of us? What does he ask of us? He asks us to fear him and to love him. He asks us to walk in his ways. He asks us to serve him with all of our heart, with all of our soul, to observe his commands, to live by his decrees. Why? Because we have to?
No.
No. Amen, no. Because it's the law?
No.
No. No. Why? Because we have had our hearts circumcised to him. What does that mean? That we have become blood-bought, blood-washed children of the Most High God. That we are bought at a high price for him. What does it mean to be circumcised to Jesus Christ? It means to cut off the garbage. To cut off the garbage and to walk in his ways. To choose that. To decide that that is absolutely what we want for our life. But he wanted it first. He chose us. I love what Beth brought. He breathed that into you. We are God's people by choice. We are God's people by our choice. We are God's people by his choice. That is a marriage, you guys, that is made in heaven. Amen? A big one?
Amen.
Because he's our God. Because we're his people. Because he is our praise. Because we choose to praise him. I don't know, man. I don't know. I guess I could just stop and go home. No? Okay. So you guys know, like, she's like, no, because then there's a whole bunch more. It says so right there. Spirituality versus religion. You guys, most of you, some of you are new to me, so let me just point it out to you. Got this here tattoo on my wrist that says spiritual, not religious. Now, it also has a really nice bracelet. I can't wear bracelets because they pull my arm ears. So I had one painted on. And it's got a broken chain, right? Because he is the chain breaker.
Amen.
He is the chain breaker of my life. So why? Why spirituality but not religious? Now, let me be absolutely clear with you why I do not like the word religion. It's not because I don't have it. I have religion. It's not because I don't believe in it. I absolutely believe in religion. It's not because God has done away with it. Has God done away with religion? Absolutely not. God hasn't done away with religion. I don't like the word religion because the world has made a stupid mess of that word. We've made a mess of that word. That word carries with it some such deep negative connotations. So many people. I am religious. But you use that word with someone that does not know Jesus Christ and walls go up. Big walls made of huge concrete that you can't even get over because they're so tall. You can't dig a hole underneath them because they go into the dirt. I was that person. I was so angry at religion when I was young. So angry. You know, I had this little tattoo on my arm, you know, under this little butterfly. It was a little tiny cross. Had that little tiny cross tattooed on me when I was like 13 in the bathroom of school. And then I got mad at God because of religion. Slapped a butterfly over it. Who knew that would become my life verse? He did. He knew that would become my life verse. I am a new creation because of Jesus Christ. And that is why there are now 7 butterflies on this arm. Because, right? I am a new creation in Jesus Christ. So true religion. What is true religion anyway? That's the question. So, it's a deep sense of commitment to God through the Trinity and a desire to walk in it. It's an engagement of your heart. It's a deep conviction. It is not total indifference. And unfortunately, you guys, I think that there's some indifference in religion today. I will tell you that I get to preach to a church that has very little indifference. And I am blessed. I am blessed by you all the time. God's word is clear about these things. He wants your heart, and he wants the rest of you too. Be fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, Romans 12:11. Be fervent. What is fervent? Be vigorously engaged with God. Vigorously engaged with Him. Not just sort of kind of a little bit here and there and maybe. That's indifference. Be fervent in the Lord. What does God require? Well, in Deuteronomy 10, 12, we see that He wants us to fear Him, to love Him, and to serve Him. Right? Circumcise your heart. And I'm not talking about a terror-driven fear, you guys.
Amen.
That is something that is so misunderstood in the world today. When we see the word fear in the Bible, it is not a terror fear. He does not desire for you to be afraid of Him. And the second saddest thing is that we could say, and we do say, and we have said, that it's more like the fear you have of your father. That don't work anymore, does it? Because nowadays people are so stinking scared of their dads that we can't even use that. We could say the fear of your boss, but that doesn't work either, so we just need to toss that word out and replace it with respect. Every time you read the word fear with the same word, God, Lord, Jesus, Spirit, just replace it. Just replace it with the word respect. And then you can embrace God's word. We need to embrace God's word in our life. Never have terror of it. Never. Deuteronomy 36, love your God with all your heart, with all your soul, that you may live. That you may live. That you may walk through life and just not walk like a zombie, right? But no, like live. Ride your motorcycle in the name of Jesus. And if you don't do that, what do? Do you hike the mountain? Man, yo, if you hike the mountain, true religion is a powerful thing. Real spiritual religion is a powerful thing. It's life. It's absolute life. It's that breath that He breathes into us. I don't know how you do it every week. I just don't, but you just get right here with me. And I love it. It's not half-hearted. It's not dutiful. It's not because I have to. It's not a Saturday night activity followed by a week-long party of self. Do you guys get that? It is not a Saturday night activity. It is followed by you walking through life, having a party for yourself. It starts in your heart, right there where we invited Christ to live. We invited Him in, right? We asked Him to come into this heart of ours. That's the seat of our religion. We invited Him to come into our heart. We asked Him to reign there. Reign there. If He's reigning there, what did He bring there? He brought goodness there. He brought love there. He brought faith there. He brought righteousness there. He brought all those things into your heart when you invited Him in there. Do we push Him out himself? Come on in. Sorry, I got this. It's not just lip service. It's not appearances. It's not just applications. 2 Timothy 3:5, having a form of godliness but denying its power. Ugh. You guys, we have a form of godliness that is powerful.
Amen.
And if we invite it in and then we deny it, its very own power in our life, shame on us. It's powerful what He brings into our life. It's not boring. It's not half-hearted. Do you have holy affection for your religion? 2 Timothy 1:6. So we're going from the front of the book to the back of the book. So we're going way toward the back of the book, just a couple books in front of the end of the book. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6, for this reason I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God. Fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands, for the Spirit of God gave us, for the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. It gives us that. That means we have it. We're not looking for it. We're not wondering where it is. We have it. It has been given to us already. Guess what? What he has given you, he expects you to use. I know, right? You get this gift, do you just stick it on a shelf somewhere? He's given you this gift. He expects you to use it. And a gift is completely useless until it is used. And have you ever gone into your closet and gone, man, I don't know who I got that from, but I need to get rid of that. I never use it. I think it's unfortunate that sometimes that is exactly what Christianity is to me. And it should never, ever be that. It's not something we stick in our back pocket and pull out when it's convenient. Are we his people? Are we using his power? Are we using his love to love others? Have we learned how to use his love to love us? So that we can love others? Are we using that sound mind that he's given us, or are we letting the hamster run on the wheel? He has given us a sound mind. And when our mind is not sound, it is because somebody's playing hamster on the wheel. Now, in the name of Jesus, get off my wheel. Right? And please remember that when you evoke the power of Jesus' name, do it out loud. Do not do that in your head. Do not whisper it around in your head. You have the helmet of salvation on your head. The enemy cannot hear you do that quiet self-talk thing. He can't read your mind. He can speak into it. So when you speak against him, you do it out loud. Get off my hamster wheel. Only Jesus belongs there. In Jesus' name. Is our religion on fire? Is your religion on fire? Man, I pray your religion is on fire, Christian. I pray it is. I pray it's on fire like in Luke chapter 24, verse 32. They asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? Were not our hearts on fire when Jesus spoke to us? This is the disciples, you guys, but we are his disciples, you guys, right? Did we talk about that last week? We are his disciples. And he still speaks to us. And are our hearts on fire because he has said something? Or are we lukewarm? Is your religion at work in you? Is the Holy Spirit at work in you? Or is it asleep? Is it a burning fire that the world can see? Or have you put it under something somewhere? This is why the word religion bothers me. We're a society of sleeping Christians. Unfortunately, we've given religion a bad name. But we can give it a good name. We also weren't the first to do it. Right? We absolutely were not the first to do it. In John chapter 5, verse 39, you think that studying the scriptures can give you eternal life? He said. Do you think that studying the scriptures can give you eternal life? Do ya? Your religion won't get you into heaven. Jesus rebuked the religious regularly. Regularly he rebuked the religious. Regularly he did it because they failed to believe. And that's what he wanted. He wanted more than anything. All he wants, I say it all, he just wants you to believe that he is Jesus Christ. That Father God is Father God. That he loved you so much that he sent Jesus Christ to this earth. And that when Jesus Christ went and ascended into heaven, that he left with us the Holy Spirit. He wants us to believe that. He wants us to use that. He wants us to exercise that in our lives. Exercise it in our lives. Do we exercise our religion? Do we exercise our faith? Do we exercise our spirituality? Or do we exercise our self-will? What are we exercising? God's word says that we run the race. We strive for the prize. We wrestle with God. We fight with weapons of warfare. These are exercising movements. This is not, and again, I'll say it again, you think you can have church at your kitchen table, get your butt up and get to church. Right? Because we exercise together. These are not words of just sitting around. These are words of movement. The exercise of religion. We exercise to the degree that we are fit. Right? You guys know that I'm a personal trainer in my personal life. I don't take people that are brand new into physical training and expect them to lift 150 pounds or to do 10 push-ups in 20 seconds or less. Right? I take people where they are. If we are new to our faith, we fight at that level. But we need discipleship like we talked about last week. We need people to get shoulder to shoulder with us and say, I know you're new at this, but let's move to the next place. Let's go to the next place. Let's learn to fight with these weapons of warfare. Let's learn to rise up. And we strive to get faithfully fit. I want you to get faithfully fit so that you can fight. Because there is a war on. There is a war on. And we need to engage with a determination to win the battle. Are we exercising self-will or are we exercising God's will? Are we engaged in our own self, or are we engaged with God? Is God our husband? What moves us in the action? What motivates us? The things that we have affection for, right? If you are in love with your dog, you might be motivated to walk your dog, right? If you are motivated by money, you're going to go work. If you're motivated by whatever, the things that we have affection for are the things that motivate us. Amen. We do the things we want to do. Look at your spare time. Challenge. Accept it. Heads like this, or like this. Heads like this. Yes, challenge accepted. Look at your spare time. What goes there? This is your movement. This is your affection. If all of your spare time is spent on something other than Jesus Christ, there your affection lies also. Covetous, teased about that earlier, right? Or want, let's just break it down into a simple word. Want, money, power, prestige, ambition, lust. Where is your spare time spent? Humans in general are super, super busy. Busy, 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 busy. They choose their busyness by their desires. Choose their busyness by their wants. Choose their busyness by whatever moves their heart. What moves us in our life will be our affection. If our heart belongs to Jesus Christ, our affection should be there also. It should be what moves us. It should be where we spend our spare time. And I am not saying, because if you know me, you know that I do a lot of stuff. But my day starts with Jesus Christ. And when I get to doing other stuff and my day gets stupid, I get back to Jesus Christ. And when I get going in my day again, and the day gets stupid again, I move back to Jesus Christ. because there my affection lies. But not only my affection, my power. My power lies in Him. I am not going to get moved away from stupid by engaging with stupid. Amen? Amen. Our hearts are moved by our affections. A person who has knowledge of the Word is not nearly as powerful as somebody who's engaged in the Word. You can know all kinds of stuff. You can know, you can hear, you can study, you can memorize. But if you're not moved by it, if you're not truly, truly moved by it, and I mean it has a profound effect on you, in a deep, rooted fashion, then you are a hearer but not a doer of these things. And if you are a hearer but not a doer of these things, then you are lacking true affection for Him. And I know, and I said that in the beginning of this, that the Word of God is challenging. And it is. It's meant to be. So we have to think about it. Everything that we work for is worth it. True religion, it's a result of affections like fear, respect, right? Hope, love, hatred, desire, joy, sorrow, gratitude, compassion, zeal. We tremble at what we've just heard. We tremble at what we've just heard. Holiness moves us to a place where we tremble with respect for the Lord. Deep inside of us, deep inside of us, we hope in God and we hope in His promises. Psalm 146:5 says, when we place our hope in Him, we will not be disappointed. Psalm's in the middle of the book. Psalms 146:5, when we place our hope in Him, we will not be disappointed. Happy is the one whose hope is in the Lord. Joyful is one whose hope is in the Lord. We love. Love is more important than any other command. We are called to it. How did Jesus love in so many ways? Sometimes soft and gentle. Sometimes strongly. Your love with your friends, with your loved ones, with your church, with your family, sometimes soft and gentle, sometimes strongly. Love can be both things. We hate sin. Proverbs 8:13, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. It is okay to hate some things. Right? It is okay to just get right up, straight up, bold about hating some things. I will not tolerate that. That will have no place in my life. I will not put up with that garbage around me. It is okay to do that. Jesus Christ flipped tables over. Right? We desire. Guys, these are holy affections. We desire. Psalms 42. Again, Psalms 42 in the middle of the book. Psalms 42, as the deer pants for streams of water, my soul pants for You, God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God? Every minute of every day. Every minute of every day. Are you a deer panting for God in your life? Reaching out for Him with that deep desire that we reach out for other things. We all know desire, but are we engaging in God? We have joy. Psalm 37:4. Take joy in the Lord and He will give you the desires of your heart. He wants you to desire. He wants you to desire after things. This scripture does not say He will give you the covetousness of your heart. We've got to be able to discern the difference in God's word. Very often people are going to really want that. The scripture says you didn't. Careful. We have joy, Psalm 37:4. Take joy in the Lord. take joy in the Lord? Is your love with the Lord joy? Or is it work? Take joy in your relationship with Him. We have sorrow. Blessed are those who mourn, Matthew 5. God comforts the mourning. When we are broken, when we are hurting, when we are sorrowful, God comforts us. He is the comfort of my soul. When I am caught in that dark, dark place, He is my light. You guys, darkness cannot live in the face of light. You can always turn the light on in the darkness, but you gotta flip the switch. We have gratitude. When you're caught in that dark place, stop and write yourself a list. When you turn the hot water spigot, does hot water come out? You're having a good day. When you woke up in the morning, did you see? Did you walk? When you were hurting, did you follow me? We have compassion. Psalm 37:21, the righteous give generously. We have compassion for one another. We give to one another. We give of our time, we give of our energy, we give of our gifts, we give of our money. People give us red trailers. Right? Honestly, it's the little tiny things, and that's not a little tiny thing, don't get me wrong, but it's, you never know what you have given and how that's going to touch someone. So we have compassion and we give. Put the back of the book, Revelation. Last chapter in the book, Revelation. Revelation chapter 3, speaking to a church. Revelation chapter 3, verse 15. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither cold hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. Have you ever had something lukewarm in your mouth that's supposed to be hot?
This is sucks.
Right? When we are lukewarm, it just sucks. We need to not be lukewarm. We need to be zealous.
Amen.
We need to choose to be the hot water spigot. We turn it and hot water comes out. Right? Or the cold water spigot, we turn it and cold water comes out, but it is definitely one or the other. It is definitely, definitely one. What are we? What are our affections to our religion? What are our affections to our spirituality? What are they? Are they powerful? Are they awake? Are they alive? Are they moving? Are they visible? Those are the things that we need to be. Our spiritual affections need to display our true religion, and we need to give that word a good name. Because people, whether we like that word or not, people have tagged us with it. They see that cross, and we're religious. Your affections better line up. And when our affections line up with it, Jesus Christ will receive all the glory. All the glory. All the glory. And people will not be afraid to love Him. They will light a fire of respect. And they will have great joy in loving Him. Because He first loved them. Amen. Lord God, thank you. Thank you that you have loved us from the beginning of the book. You didn't take one second to think about whether or not you loved us. You breathed your life into us. And in that moment, you claimed us as your own. You have never stopped loving us. In all of the times and in all of the ways that we have turned our back on you, that we have walked away from you, that we have disowned you, in all the ways, through the entire story, all the way to today, you have loved us and you have chased after us with holy affection. And all you really want from us in return is life. But we want to give you more than that. We want to give you respect. We want to give you love. We want to give you joy. We want to give you zealousness. We want to give you everything. We want to paint after you as the deer paints after the water. And Lord, we know that you love us even in our broken times, even in our hurting times. We know that you are the light, you are the rock of our salvation, and we will lean into you and experience you. And then, Lord, we will take you, and we will show you. We will put that lamp on a stand for all to see. We will show you to the world around us. Because you are our light, our rock, our salvation. And we will fear no one because you love us. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for listening.